All right, church, we want to look at three things around the topic of Jesus, the risen Savior today. I've broken it down quite simply for you into three categories, if you will, or three steps, really. Looking, seeking, and seeing. First, looking, check out verse 11. Look what it says. But Mary stood outside by the tomb weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. If you're a note taker, maybe just circle the words looked into the tomb or highlight them. The first question I want to ask you is, have you done this? Have you ever looked into the tomb? Okay, it's going to sound like I'm bragging, but I have literally. You go to Israel, you take a tour there. We do this every couple years. And the supposed site, I believe, many do believe, of Gordon's Calvary. We end up there, and it's sort of like this climax of the whole trip is when you go to the garden tomb and you stop and then you stoop because it's this small hole, and then you look inside the tomb just like Mary did. And let me just say this. It's also hilarious if you visit this place. Why? Well, because as I told the people at our Gravity Church service recently, the Garden Tomb site has got to be the only major site in the whole world where the main feature is what isn't there. No joke. All other sites, think about it with me. You pay to see something. Anybody here been to Disneyland? Right? Okay, if you take kids to Disneyland, you're kind of banking on the photo with Mickey, right? I mean, you don't see Mickey. You're going to hear about it for the next 10 years or whatever. Anybody here been to SeaWorld? Anybody? SeaWorld? Where are you? What do you expect to see when they take off the covers from the pool and they start the show? Just shout it out. Really easy. Yeah. Orcas. Dolphins, right? Come on, people. Wake up. Whales. If there's no Shamu, you're ripped off. Let's be honest. Where is Shamu? Okay, this is an issue. And this makes sense. You want your money back, but not at the garden tomb. I kid you not, it is surreal. It is the opposite. It's got to be the only place where people are pumped about what's missing. And they talk about it. Did you see that? What? Nothing. It's empty. Gone. Isn't it great? And everyone's smiling. And at first you're kind of like, this is weird. And then you're swept into it. You're taking pictures next to the nothing area yourself with friends, right? You're like, this is where the main exhibit isn't. It's the most surreal thing. You're caught right up into it. You get home, you're showing your friends, what's this? It's nothing. Sweet, isn't it? All I see is dirt. Exactly, you're getting it. Nothing. That's what's exciting when you go there. And here's why it's exciting, whether you're here checking out God Church or Jesus, which is great, or whether you know this truth and need to be reminded, refreshed, and brought back to the reality of it, here's the deal. If the tomb isn't empty, Paul said our faith is futile. It's a waste. Do you know that the whole premise of the Christian faith survives on an empty tomb? It's a decision that every person has to figure out themselves. And it's great because as we catch up with this gal Mary in John 20 verse 11, it is here that she begins to look into the tomb. And it's here, may I challenge you wherever you are, to look afresh into the tomb and see what Mary saw. Here it says she stoops and looks in. I love this. See, for some of you here today, the way to find God for you is to come down a little lower, to stoop. It's a picture of how you find God. If you go to the garden tomb, you realize they weren't into like renos when they did tombs back then. You know that, right? I mean, they made the hole big enough that you can step over it and go into it. But there's no like patio doors. They weren't like remodeling this thing. They made just a small hole, and you literally have to bow down and get into this thing. It's a great picture. It's a humility that God is looking for before he reveals himself when you're looking into him. The Bible says this way, it says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. But it also says, He gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So you have to come humbly to God. And the tomb perhaps has the greatest need for this humble approach. Because see, to stand tall with arms folded, maybe this is you. Well, that's easy to sort of be in this position of, well, I don't believe. Well, that's the easiest position to be in. Think about it. Nothing has to change in you to say, I don't believe. But to look in, to start seeking and perhaps see the risen Savior, it pushes you beyond where you are. If you're unmoved, if you're unchanged, or you're unaffected, though, you just remain in the same position. I ask you today, are you in the same place when it comes to the things of Jesus? Or are you willing to look into it and begin to seek after the Lord? For me, I can share years back, I felt ironically at the top of my game several years ago, running a comedy club in Kelowna and doing quite well financially. And I think on paper, things like I was a DJ in Kelowna, and I ran a TV show, and I was living the life, so to speak, from my perspective, but I was miserable. And it's only when I begin to humble myself and sort of go, maybe I don't have it all figured out. Begin to lower myself and begin to seek that God revealed himself today and to me. And today, perhaps, some of you need to be encouraged to do the same, to get lower and look into the tomb. Now, let's look at what Mary saw. Look at verse 12. She saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet where the body of Jesus had lain. Can you get the scene? Then they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said, because they've taken away my Lord and I do not know where they've laid him. So first off, here's what she sees. Now, can you picture yourself there? You go in, you're looking for somebody to pay your respects perhaps, and there's more to it than that. But rather than seeing the body, you see two angels sitting there. Now, first off, for you Bible students, you note takers, the two angels is kind of a cool picture, if you will. You've got the two angels on either side, it says, of his head and his feet. You've got, if you will, this picture, the blood-spattered mercy seat, the linen garments, and of course, the picture is the Ark of the Covenant. You can see them right there, the cherub. And it's as though God is saying, this is now a new mercy seat. My son has paid the price for sin. The way is open into the presence of God. No longer the old covenant, but you shall enter freely by the blood of another, the blood of the Lamb. Now you got to understand this girl's love for Jesus. Because I don't know about you, but when I read this and we read her reaction in a minute, it's a little shocking. She's crying. She sees two angels. She bypasses her question and says, where is my Lord? Would that be your reaction? I don't know about you, but I'd be like, angels. I'd just stop there. I would have a moment, wouldn't you? I'd sort of be snapping photos going, angels, wow. But there's none of that with Mary. And to me, this is a picture of the incredible love. This is one of the only places in the Bible where someone encounters angels and they're not stricken with fear. I think it's easy to just sort of read over it. But she goes in, okay, angels, great. Where is the Lord? I'm thinking angels is a big deal. But let me just say this. It's not a big deal in comparison to the Lord. When you've met the Lord, when you've been with the Lord, the supernatural and the spiritual doesn't hold a candle to the creator of all of the above. This shows that Mary is so grieved at the loss of Jesus that she's unaffected even by the appearance of angels. Now again, one at the place of his head, one at the place of his feet, and you're looking in, you're expecting to find this body, but instead you find these two angels. That's got to throw you. And look at her reaction and her position. It says that she's weeping. Verse 11, and then again, verse 13, she's weeping or she's crying. And now what's her reaction to all this? She's just crying, and I ask you this question. What do you think? Is it joy or pain at this point? I mean, the obvious thing is it's pain. I think her thought is, where is my Lord? And that's a great question for some of you here today. Where is your Lord? Because it presupposes that you have a Lord. Now, some of you say, well, I don't have a Lord. But I suggest that we all have some semblance of a Lord or a God in our life. Now, you may say, no, Joel, I don't. But let me just put it this way. Your God, small g, is what you give your energy to, what you give the most time and your talents, your treasures, your focus, where you daydream to. That's the thing that is most getting your worth or your worth-ship, if you will. Let me ask you today, is it your job? Is it a person? Is it your pleasures? Or is it the Lord? Her heart was moved because her Lord had moved. Look what they say. Woman, why are you weeping? Now, first off, if you're an angel, you can get away with this, right? If you're married or dating someone, gentlemen, listen up. Don't say this line, okay? Because you might be met with something like, that's the problem. You don't know why, but you should know. I'm just saying. So I've heard. I don't know personally, but I've just heard. If she's crying, woman, why are you weeping? Might not go over well. Just FYI. You see the guy scribbling down. Write that down. That's caused years of pain. Listen. But seriously, she says, note her answer here. She says, because they've taken away my Lord. I pose to you again the same thought. Pause for a second. I ask you, what is your Lord, your God? What is that thing that if it was taken away from you? And the Bible calls this an idol. Idols aren't just wooden statues. They're anything that you love more than God or anything that takes the place of the one who made you in your heart and life. What is that thing that if they took it away from you, you'd be constantly weeping and unsatisfied? Oh, sure, if there's personal loss in our life, it's not wrong. We don't walk around here and go, hey, why are you crying? Your car broke down. What's the matter with you? We don't do that. You know, you lost your job. Hey, you should feel that. Something go wrong in a relationship, a marriage, or... But let me ask you, what's your God? What's the thing that causes that kind of weeping? What's your idol, if you will? Is it a vehicle? A higher paycheck? Is it a drug? Is it your money or your house? Even your kids? And though you'd have a right to be upset, you would, and so does she. But the Lord wants you to turn from anything today that is not Him and turn towards the only place of total security, and that's Him. And discover that joy that comes, that's not found in a bottle or some trip somewhere or changing locations or jobs or even fully in any one person, but in the man, Jesus Christ. When Jesus is your Lord, then you can weep. But listen, you weep differently. When Jesus is your Lord, you can cry over personal loss, but you never cry over the future because you recognize this world's not the main event. The best is yet to come. So we grieve, yes, the scripture says, but not as those who are without hope, because we recognize this is testing and training for the great hope after. We have eternal perspective. Well, sure, you can cry over personal loss, but never over your personal destiny or future when you know Jesus. Never over your eternal destiny or security when you know Jesus. Never over your future body or location when you know Jesus. That's all secure in Christ Jesus. So first, friends, you got to look into the tomb afresh today. Figure out if you believe. Then what? Well, for me... Personally, several years ago, as I shared, I went from looking into this thing called Christianity to begin to seek after it. Check it out. Look what happens. Verse 14. Now, when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" This is getting annoying for her. "Whom?" Whom are you seeking? I like to think he said it with more tact. But anyway, she's supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." I don't know if you recognize how funny this line is. On a first read of this, you kind of go, "Well, that's sweet." You know, she's like, "Hey, just tell me where he is. I want to know where he is." But it's so much more than that. If you read the word, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, I will take him away." The words, "I will take him away" in the Greek, guess what that means? I will put him over my shoulder personally. No joke. Like fireman style, okay, here? And remove the body myself. You're like, "Oh, Joel, you're just having too much fun here." No, literally, that's what it means. What's really funny is watching really serious scholars and commentators sort of trip out on this verse. They're like, "Well, maybe she had some sort of device, some rolling mech." No. Wheels on a pulley system. No. Come on. She says, "I'll take him away. I'll put him over my shoulder." So we're left with the question, is Mary like sort of like Wonder Woman? Or seriously though, is she built like a German tank? Is that what it is? We don't know. I guess I'll find out one day. That's going to be awkward. "Mary, hi." I did not mean the German tank thing. So sorry. "We're in heaven. What are you going to do?" Okay, listen. She throws me over her shoulder. I want you to catch this, church. It's not just the humor of it, it's the love of it that astounds me. See, this has nothing to do with math. I actually have this theory she's this tiny little gal. You know why? It just accentuates the point. This is not about math, it's all about heart. She so seeks Jesus. She will carry him with her if she has to. That's the level of seeking that God rewards. Now, I just want to say this. For some of you, perhaps you could say, "I used to seek the Lord, but I had this bad church experience, so, you know, I kind of stopped. Hey, I'm here on Easter. What more do you want?" I get it. Others of you go, "Hey, I used to seek the Lord, but, I mean, I got burnt by a Christian. Hey, sorry that happened." You're like, "Well, I put my faith in Christians and they let me down." And yes, they will. But Jesus will never let you down. And if there's that pull or that tug on your heart, it's okay with the mind to begin to look into the things of the Lord again. But more than that, with the heart to begin to seek after him yourself. To come back if you've been away. To say, "Okay, that's it, Lord. I'm sorry. You got me. You're knocking on my heart." Recognize the love that Mary had is a seeking that is rewarded. Look at verse 14. When she said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. First off, look what happens here. She turns around and she sees Jesus, but she doesn't know why it's him. Don't shout out your answer, but I pose the question, why? Hasn't she been with Jesus the whole time? Yes. Didn't she have a pretty good look at who Jesus was from day one? Absolutely. So why now all of a sudden is there this moment which some of you get in the shake and greet where you turn around and you're like, "I cannot remember your name. Welcome to Mountain Springs, you guy." Right? You've done that. I'm not alone on this, am I? You turn around, you're like, "Hey, buddy, how's the kids? I don't have any." I know that. I mean, the praying for the whatever. All right. Why has she forgotten Jesus? I think scholars come up with some of the funniest answers to this question right here. First one I read, the guy goes on this long, exhaustive description of what happens when ladies cry. Yes, he's dead now, so I'll leave that one up to you, what happened to him. Okay. And but seriously, I'll modernize it for you. He said, basically, you've got crying and blurred vision. It's sort of this picture of, like, you know, makeup and the tears turn into this big car wash of mascara, I guess. I don't know. I'm going to leave that one alone. But somebody else says, no, it's early in the morning. It's dark. Okay. Somebody else says it's his resurrected body. It looks different, maybe. Someone else says, no, no, no. If you come out of the tomb and the light starts coming up, it's a blinding light. Maybe you've seen the movie. That's what they do in the movie often, right? They're like, oh, and there's Jesus. They're like, who are you? Are you the gardener? No. The gardener does not look this good. Trust me. I like this one. Some say perhaps he veiled her eyes like he did in another account on the road to Emmaus for the right moment to reveal himself to her like he does to us. We're veiled. The Bible says the enemy, actually, different than this account, puts a veil over our eyes before we know Jesus. Then the veil's lifted and we go, there he is. We go from seeking to seeing. Maybe. Maybe it's just a Jesus sort of power thing, you know? I don't know. What I do know is this. Either way, she doesn't get that it's him. So she turns, she sees Jesus, but she doesn't know it's him. And as I pray over this, it gets my heart. See, I don't know why she didn't see him. But I know that some of you are in the same boat. But it's far more serious than her momentary not seeing him. Some of you, you're like this in that Jesus has been standing beside you for some time. He's been walking beside you. He's been inviting you. In fact, if you've got a Bible, keep your finger here and jump forward one block and just a few chapters to Acts chapter 3, Peter, when he preaches his sermon to the Jews. In Acts chapter 3, verse 19, here's his message to them. This is the same message to me. Look what he says. Repent, therefore, and be converted. Pause. Here's what he's saying. I'm telling you about Jesus. I'm putting Jesus right in front of you. But it's yours to make a decision of the mind and the will to do an about turn from where you are and turn towards Jesus and from your sin. You say, what is that? That's the word repentance, metanoia in the Greek. It means do a 180 from your sin towards Jesus. Look what he says. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. Here it is. So that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. He's there. He wants to come in, but you've got to turn from sin. Now look, if you're already saved and you're like, I can't see him right now. Same verse, same application. Your sins are blocking him out. He wants to blot out your sins. Now he paid for them once on the cross. But the Bible says in 1 John that we have to come sort of daily and get washed and forgiven so that we can see clearly. Look what he says. Times of refreshing come from the presence of the Lord. Verse 20, that he may send Jesus Christ who was preached to you before. Interesting. Jump back to John. Just sort of praying through this passage. And I'm seeing this moment where she can't see Jesus, but Jesus is right there. And I get this concept in my heart and mind that for many of you, Jesus for some time has been right there. And you've never repented. Oh, you've heard the message. It was, as Peter says, this has been preached to you before, but you've never turned and had your sins paid for by Jesus. You've just sort of crossed your arms and said, no, no, I'm going to go on without him. Well, today he walks beside you. He invites you. And this, for some of you, isn't the first time you've heard this, but the invitation is the same. Maybe your response is, well, Joel, come on. I mean, I go to church. Isn't that the same? No, it's not the same. There's a definitive moment in a life where you place your faith fully in Jesus Christ. It's not, oh, I went to church. There's a moment in time where you move from looking into Christianity and just a mental approach. You begin to seek with your heart, and it leads you past that to where you've actually now seen him. And Jesus is inviting you to do that today, to go past looking into the topic, next into seeking and then seeing. Look what verse 15 says. Now Jesus asked this same question, why are you weeping? Who are you seeking? That's interesting. He now adds this. Who are you seeking? Here's the second person who asks her, why are you weeping? And he adds these words, whom are you seeking? I want to ask you the same question. Who or what are you seeking after today? Can I respectfully suggest and just sort of hold back on your response to what I'm about to say? But can I respectfully suggest you're already seeking Jesus? You say, no, I'm not. You say, well, that's ridiculous. I'm not a religious person like you guys. I'm not really, I'm just sort of, let me present to you what I mean. Take any pursuit of something. The idea at the end or the goal or the vision you have is either fulfillment, happiness, or joy, right? I mean, nobody gets a job working somewhere and says, well, I just want to be miserable. This will be great. Right? No, none of you, anybody here buy a large screen TV? Men, help me here. Did you buy a large screen TV? It's okay. It's not confession hour. You're like, your wife's like, put your hand up. I did. I bought a large TV. I did. Guess not. Maybe it's large as yours. But listen, you didn't buy that to add to your depression. Do you understand? This is easy church, okay? This is the easy part. Nobody goes on vacation thinking this is going to hurt us in the long run. Let's do it, honey. It'll ruin us. This is simple math. So, the question you must answer is, how far should I take that equation? Some seek thrills and they do it through the illegal direction, say illicit drugs. Or the idea for them of satisfaction through the drugs supersedes or trumps the legality of it. Stay with me. But it's still a pursuit of pleasure. Ultimately, when you ask them, just love whatever it is. Some seek it through accomplishment. When I get this jewel, when I arrive here, when I earn this much or buy that thing, then I'll have arrived. Joy, fulfillment. It's the same end game. Do you understand? Some money, some sex. But put aside whether you believe me for a second, what if the ultimate promise or pursuit was none of these? Just pause for a second. What if the ultimate satisfaction relied solely on your relationship with the one who made you? Now flip it around. You're not God. Thank the Lord for that. But if you were and you created these little beings on this table and released them into the world, ha ha. And what if you inherently knew inside of them that the best joy they'll get is to turn back to you and have relationship with the one who made them, and they start building things and worshiping the things they're building? What would you do? I know what I'd do. I'm like, okay, well, okay, let's start again. I'd quickly put that down, wouldn't you? But not God. No, in his sovereignty, he allows it to go on, sees them pushing away from the very... the one who made them, who knows how they're made and how to satisfy them. And instead does what? They don't get it. They don't get it, and they won't get it. I'm going to go down and become one of them. And I'm going to show them all these pursuits, all these things that bring dissatisfaction, all these things that make things worse. Well, that's not it. And they require payment. I'm going to pay for it. And I'll take all their sin, all the consequence of their mistakes upon my own shoulders for them. Surely then they'll see the love I have for them in turn in relationship to the only thing that can give lasting fulfillment. What if you figured out that the ultimate satisfaction relies solely on the one
who not only made you, but paid for you?
What if you discovered all other pursuits paled in comparison? That's my story, and it's many of yours. Oh, I'm after this, this, this. Wait a minute, I'm looking into Jesus. Now I'm seeking him. Wow, now I'm found by him, and I see him. Oh my goodness, what a fool. Why did I care about this and this and this? So does he ask Mary, jumping back in, why are you weeping? Because he doesn't know. No, that's the angels. They probably don't know. He knows, but he wants her to identify for herself what she's truly seeking as the risen Savior, just as he does for some of you. And I ask the question, who are you seeking? What are you seeking? Is it causing weeping or true lasting joy? Has it let you down or never let you down? Because Jesus is the latter. Proverbs 8:17 says, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. That's the picture of Mary's life. She comes early. She's first to the tomb. I want to seek the Lord. Some of you know the Lord, but you couldn't say in this season, you're seeking him. Others of you say, well, I'm studying him, but you're not seeking. Maybe even I'm reading about him, but are you seeking? Is it personal? Is it relational? Jesus comes through the unexpected person, viewed as a gardener. He comes through the unexpected person at the unexpected time in the unexpected place. And the Lord will come to you through a brother or a sister or a family member, some of you through an invite in the mail that you got. Yeah, I suppose we should go to church. But so often, like Mary's, our eyes are so filled with tears, we don't even recognize when the Lord is speaking to us, saying, it's me, I'm here. And he wants us to push past even seeking and into seeing. Check it out as we wrap this up. Verse 16 to 18. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him, Rabboni, which is to say teacher. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say to them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father. That's encouraging. And to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples, here it is, that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. If you look at these three verses and you ask the question, did she see the Lord? Oh, yeah. She sees the Lord. Literally, look at these words again. Verse 17, do not cling to me. Now, some of you go, that's a bit standoffish. I mean, what's the deal? But in the original language, don't cling to me is a bit of an understated saying. The idea is she is not letting go. Do you understand? Okay, non-huggers, this is for you right here. She's got him in a chokehold, one guy says. And it's like he's tapping out, uncle, uncle. But really, these words, I joke you not, do not cling to me. They're written in the ongoing tense, meaning this is a bit of time. And that's the love of Mary that drives her to this, Jesus. She's on him, right? Chokehold, he's trying to get out. He can't, and then he says these words, don't cling to me, right? It's sort of like this awkward time thing. Maybe it gets awkward. And he's like, okay, unclasp, please. But also, what does he say? Hey, listen, I haven't ascended to my Father. What's he saying? It's okay, Mary. I'm still going to be here for 40 more days. You'll see me again. He makes guest appearances all over Israel. And then he hits the Mount of Olives and he ascends right there. He sits at the right hand of the Father where he is today. He's our soon coming King. But catch this. See, in the humor of it, I hope you notice this. She sees him and he says, Mary. Now that's funny too. Here's why. Everyone is called Mary. You do know this, right? Mary's the most common female name in Israel at the time of this writing. In fact, in Jesus' life, of the ones we know recorded, there's four Marys. Anybody got three friends with the same name? It's a bit challenging, isn't it? Here, that's my brother Larry, my other brother Larry, my other... Right? That's for anyone over 30. Okay, listen. Four Marys. Those are just the ones we know, but scholars are great on this. It's a little out there, but I admit, almost all the scholars suggest he would have had to have said each name in a specific way. Was it Mary or Mary? I don't know. All I know is this. He said her name in a way where she knew. Something happened. Mary. Now your translation may say that she responded Rabboni, and it may say teacher in there, but it more specifically speaks of Lord and Master. And it's interesting that Mary's name is Beloved. Jesus sort of says, my beloved Mary. And she won't simply stop at looking into the topic or even seeking after the man. She must see her risen Lord. I'm going to invite the worship team up on a close of the story. I like to ski. Any skiers out there? I remember, right now I feel pretty confident skiing. I'm not amazing like some of you, but I'm pretty confident. But I remember it wasn't always that way. I learned to ski in Mount Washington, Vancouver Island. And the first class I went into, somebody from there, great. First class I went to was called Skiing is Believing. What a lie. Listen. I remember I wore tie-dye jeans at the time because I didn't know they had like pants made just for skiing. And so if you've ever skied with jeans, it's the worst ever, especially if they're skinny tie-dye jeans because you're soaked the whole day and you're like walking around like this, right? Okay. All I remember is they would put you on these skis and I was like this bow-legged guy doing this and just shaking and falling over all the time. But they said, oh, skiing is believing. Once you start skiing, you'll start believing. And it didn't happen right away. There was a lot of timidity, a lot of kind of fear. Okay, it's not like traumatic, I'm over it, but listen. You're sort of this nervous wreck. And then all of a sudden, you get it. You're like, hey, this is good. And you probably go too far. You think you're amazing, right? And then you fall off a chairlift and you're brought back to reality. Well, then years later, you're skiing along and I can remember going by one of these schools and getting that same sort of like, you know, look at those guys. The same way I felt. Watching them sort of fumble their way through. The idea that our world has is prove it to me and I'll believe. The idea that God presents is believe it and I'll prove it. The doing part, the skiing, is believing. Once you believe in Jesus, you see Jesus. And you're no longer this, oh, I don't know, I've got to fight it, oh, and you're falling all the time. No. All of a sudden you get into this place, you're like, wow, he's real. The veil is lifted. And you go from just seeking, and you see Jesus. Mary Magdalene in verse 18, she goes and announces to the disciples, I've seen the Lord. And that he said these things. God wants you to say the same. I've seen the Lord, the risen Lord. She saw him. That's what we need. A head that looks into it, a heart that seeks after it, and a faith that seizes it and then sees him. You believe and then you see.